We're all good people who want to go to the same place, you know, we're headed towards heaven, and you believe what you believe, I believe what I believe, and we just love one another, you know, we'll get there. And I try to water down my message for the secular people that are in Seattle. But is that a good message for me as a Seventh-day Adventist to be given? It's not. It's not, because the Bible clearly says that there's only how many ways to get to the Father?
One way.
Only one way. You can't get to the Father through a Christian. You can't get to the Father through a Buddha. You can't get to the Father through Mother Mary. Only one way. That's through Jesus Christ. I am the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father but by me. It might sound a little, you know, prideful, bigoted in our society today. But that's what the Bible says. The only way you can get to God the Father is through Jesus Christ, His Son. So when I repented of my attitude in the beginning, and now whenever, wherever I go, I say there's only one way. You can get to heaven. There's only one way to eternal life. Only one way to God the Father. And that's through Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible teaches that God is concerned about your physical health here and now just as much as He is concerned about your eternal life, right? About your soul. 3 John verse 2, one of my favorite Bible things, says, "Brethren, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in what? Be in health. I want you to be healthy, as even as thy soul prospers." Of course, church is here so that you can learn about God, so that you can live for, you know, get the tools so that you can live for eternity in heaven. That's true. But God says, just as much, I am concerned about your health here and now, today. And so God wants you to be healthy and prosperous just as much as He wants to deliver your soul from sin. So, Jesus Christ, in ministry on earth, He actually spent more time treating sick people, healing, than even preaching and teaching. So, if we want to be like Jesus Christ, if we want to model our ministry after Jesus Christ, maybe that's something that we need to think about. We need to help people with their physical needs in order to be able to win people's hearts. So find out their needs. If they have physical health problems, yes, you need to address that. Not just be trying to, you know, get them to come to Sabbath school and learn the Bible. That's great, that's wonderful, it needs to be done. But to open their doors, you need to use the right hand, right? And the medical missionary, and that's what's going to do. And his apostles, all the apostles, after Jesus sent and went back to heaven, that's the model that they used to, right? They went around teaching and healing people in the name of Jesus Christ. And that's what we need to be doing. Now, as we go into our study of the Ten Commandments, we need to be careful here. The Ten Commandments are kind of a very unique document in the history of the world. There are only a few times recorded in the Bible where God Himself, or Jesus Christ, God Himself, wrote to His own people. Like, the Bible, by and large, is written by people who were inspired by the Holy Spirit. And they wrote down their thoughts in human words, and this is where we have the Bible. But there are a few times in the Bible where God Himself wrote with His own finger, right? The Ten Commandments, one of those times. And God Himself came down to the mountain, wrote on tables of stone His law. What are some other times you remember when God Himself wrote with His own finger, God and Jesus Christ? Handwriting on the wall. I remember in Belshazzar, when they were eating and drinking, making merry, you know, they got the holy vessel to the Lord's temple. Bloodless hand, this is the body of hand, came and wrote on the wall from the words of men and men and Jacob and Carson. Way about wanting, and not very good words. What's another time when God Himself wrote with His own people, when Jesus Christ?
Mary.
Yes, Mary Magdalene. He dragged her out, and And it says she was caught in adultery, and a lot of folks had stoned, she is stoned. And what did that Jesus Christ say? That he who has no sin has the first stone. And then what did he do? He started, he knelt down, he started writing on the sand. What did he write? Remember the little white cloth is created? What did he start writing?
The sins
of each of her accused, all a lot of the Pharisees, leaders of the church, there to trap Jesus. And Jesus knelt down and started writing each of those things, one by one. The person that was near, that was looking down, what was Jesus writing? He started writing down that person's sin. And then that person was convicted and stuck away. Another person looking down. Jesus wrote down his sin. He erased it. The next person wrote down their sin. He erased it. He was writing on sand. Right? And he erased it. Only that person who committed that sin saw what Jesus would write. Doesn't that show you the great mercy of what Jesus Christ? When he writes down our sin, he wrote it in sand. He can wash it away. It's temporary. When he wrote down the Ten Commandments, what did he write?
Stone.
So that it would be pretty much permanent. It's not eternal, but God's law is eternal, right? It's not temporary. It doesn't just wipe away by the flesh of my hand. So God's sin, he said, our sin, God said, I write upon the sand. I can wash it away. It will be as if you have never sinned. But God's law, he wrote it on the tables of stone. Wonderful promise here in Ezekiel, Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. Exodus 15, 26. If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, you give ear to his commandments and keep all these statutes, I will put none of the diseases upon you which I have brought on the Egyptians. Now, for the reason, did you put that as one of the diseases of the Egyptians?
Yeah.
Okay, so I won't go too much into this, but I cry on the Lord who heals you. Right? God promised his people way back then, thousands of years ago. He said, if you will keep my statutes, if you will keep my commandments, I will put none of these diseases upon you. And David later on says, you know, as you look back on the experience of the Israelites in the wilderness, he says, there was not evil among all his tribe, right? They were all healthy. We might think the diseases of the Egyptians, you know, what kind of ancient diseases did the Egyptians have? And there were probably a few, you know, kind of exotic Egyptian ancient diseases that they had, but by and large, you'd be surprised at what they listed. And I didn't know about this until I started studying this, but did you know there are thousands, millions of mummies still preserved in Egypt? And doctors have actually gone in, done x-ray studies, MRI studies, autopsies on these mummies to see what kind of diseases these Egyptians died from. So it's not based on, you know, ancient books or hearsay, and that they've actually done autopsies, scientific studies on these bodies. Dr. Claude Lucas did x-ray studies on 14,000 mummies, and here's a news thing here. Cemetery of 1 million mummies on earth in Egypt. 1,500-year-old desert necropolis. I didn't know there were so many mummies in Egypt. So we can clearly see, do these studies, you can tell what kind of diseases they died from. And if you look at the list that these scientists come up with, here are some of the samples of this. They're looking at some of the arteries. They can actually see, look at the arteries that they have in the bodies, in different places. And here's a list that these scientists have come up with. Heart disease, cancer, arthritis, diabetes, obesity, high blood pressure, rheumatism, sexually transmitted diseases. And this is a list of ancient Egyptian diseases that we hardly hear about today. go to the ER, if you go to the ER, you right down the road here somewhere, the hospital, very same diseases, right? You go down to Los Angeles, or Seattle, New York, the hospitals, they're filled with these diseases, right? It's not some arcane, you know, ancient disease that we don't know anything about, modern drugs that, you know, taken care of. No, God says these are diseases that came upon the Egyptians. What was his promise? If you follow my commandments, my statutes, I will put only a few of these on you. Is that what he said? None! He said, none of these diseases will be upon you that I have put on the Egyptians. As we look at our church today, are our church members plagued with these diseases? I have to say, pretty much the same inside the church and outside the church. It is true, though, that Adventists live 3 or 4 more years longer than the, you know, average person anywhere in the world, whatever neighborhood you're in. We do live in even 7 or 8 years longer than females. That's great, we live longer, but we're dying with the same diseases that the world dies from. And that was not God's will for his people. He said, I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have put upon the Egyptians. So there must be something in God's principles that will prevent these diseases from coming upon his people. It's not just miracles that God wants to perform for us. He wants to give us principles that we can live by that will prevent these diseases. You know, when we look at God's law, King David said, oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. When people today think about God's law, is that their first reaction? Oh, how I love God's law. Have you heard a lot of people say that? I love God's law so much. I think about it all day. I love God's law so much. You pretty much hear the opposite, right? God is love. He loves everyone, and he's not going to punish us so much. It's okay. The cheap grace that we hear, even in Christian churches, and sometimes even in Adventist churches, we downplay God's law. We say, you know, God is so loving, so kind, that he'll forgive you. Whatever you're doing, it's okay. God is smart. And it is true. God loves us. He wants to forgive us. But the law, God's law is not something distant do's and don'ts that all that's always, you know, condemning us and bringing us down. It's something that was nailed to the cross and not under judgment of God's law. So we don't need God's law. We don't need to think about it so much anymore. King David said, I love God's law so much, it's my meditation all the day. So, you know, we won't spend all day thinking about God's law today, but just a portion of that, just a little bit of that here, I'd like to spend with you studying God's law, which is a law of love. When you look at God's law, there is something that you do have to be careful of. You do have to be careful of. Especially in the Adventist Church, there's a book out called Zozo, Reversing the Worst Evil. This man that wrote the book, he's a layman, but he's a person who was involved in medical missionary work back in the States. And he had a really nice health worker, I forget the state, Iowa, the healer. He had a, just like what other white described in the 90s, a city center where they had a restaurant. They had many young people working there who were also Bible workers. And they had people coming in from the cities to eat at their restaurant, but they had enough time so they could talk with the people that are coming in. They had, some designed rooms where people could go and pray, where they could have Bible studies, where simple treatments, if they needed, would be held. They had a country outpost where the young people could stay so that they didn't have to live in the cities, but they could go from the outpost, come out into the city to do their mission. Missionary work. They had a wonderful missionary work going on, and he wrote this in the book here. But in the foreword of this book, Dr. Timothy Howe wrote before that. This word sozo, the word sozo in Greek can be translated in either of two ways. You can translate it either salvation or help. That first step, Matthew 1:21, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. And that word save is sozo. So you can translate sozo as salvation from sin. In Matthew 9:21, for she said within herself, if I may but touch his garment, I shall be whole. And that word whole is that same word, sozo. The healing from physical illness is sozo. Salvation from sin is also sozo. And that's where this man got the title of his book, because in the ultimate sense, both salvation and health come from just one source, Jesus Christ, God Himself. And so in the Bible, that word is interchangeable, salvation and health, so intimately combined. And in the foreword to this book, Dr. Tindall says, health education alone is not medical missionary work. You know, both Brother Rizzo here and I can spend a lot of time doing health education work. But how is just doing health education, teaching people about health, how to live a healthy life, that's not medical missionary work. Health education does not provide healing any more than the law of God provides salvation. Are you clear on that? Just knowing about how to live healthy does not provide healing any more than knowing about God's law by salvation. No matter how many times you memorize the Ten Commandments, no matter how many memory texts you put to your mind, just knowing about God's law will not bring salvation. And I order for salvation. What shall I do? There's one way. In the truest sense, health and salvation are one. Both are gained not through a knowledge of law, be it health law or moral law, but rather through God's redeeming, restoring power. Okay, you have to get that clear in our minds. The law, studying the law, is great information, but the law itself does not bring us salvation, it does not bring us health. Salvation and health only come from God's redeeming, restoring power. Okay? And so we have to make that very clear in our minds. The Bible says in Isaiah 64, we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, and we all been made as believe in our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. You know, the unclean rags, filthy rags that Isaiah is talking about, and that original word in Hebrew is actually talking about menstrual cloth. The cloth that the women would use to wipe away their menstruation. And so God says, you know, all the righteousness that you have, that you think you have, it's all filthy rags, worthless people. Even the good things that we do not contribute to your salvation. They do not a basis of your salvation. You can't even have. There's only one way to say, and Jesus said, they said, sir, what must I do to say? The people who were convicted with the apostles' preaching, they said, what do we have to do to be saved? There was only one answer. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thou and thy house. So before we get into the 10th commandment, we need to ask ourselves, where you find the gospel in the Ten Commandments. Because without the gospel, without the redeeming, restoring power of Jesus Christ, it's no use studying the Ten Commandments. So within the Ten Commandments itself, there must be some place where you can find the gospel, Jesus Christ's power to redeem and restore. What are the first words of the Ten Commandments?
I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt.
Yeah.
I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt.
The first word. words, the Ten Commandments, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Right? So look in your Bible, open your Bibles, look at Exodus chapter 20. The first words of the Ten Commandments are not, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Verse 2, Exodus chapter 20, verse 2. Here are the first words of the Ten Commandments. The Lord said all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which has brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Then he goes to the first commandment, and that's what happened, what God had done. So even before God starts writing down the first commandment, he wrote with his own words there, I am the Lord thy God, which has brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Who is it that does this for us? It's the Lord. It wasn't because Israel was such a wonderful people, a faithful people, and that they were deemed worthy to be brought out of Egypt. God said, I pity you. I want to bring my people out of Egypt. I will bring you out of slavery. I will bring you out of bondage. Actually, the Israelites had David. And they've been faithful during their time in Egypt. They've forgotten all about the gospel. They were pretty much trying to survive in their life, in being slaves in Egypt. They've been largely forgotten the principles of God's living. And God had to re-educate them. And God said, remember, I'm the one that brings you out of Egypt. Gives you freedom from sin. So right there, in the very first words of the Ten Commandments, we have the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's nothing that we do and that can save us. But it is only God's power to redeem and to restore. Alright, so here we go. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Of course, the Ten Commandments are they're a moral law. But God said, you know, if you keep my commandments, my laws, I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have put upon the Egyptians. Actually, what got me started into thinking along these lines was a lecture I heard at my natural ethics school, and a worldly professor from the University of Washington came as a guest lecturer, and he gave us a lecture on a health topic. And the way he presented it, it got me thinking, wow, that sounds just like the Tenth Commandment. Thou shalt not covet. And I thought, oh, if that is actually a health law, it's connected with our health, then maybe all the other commandments have a connection with our health also. And so that's what got me started thinking along these lines and developing that theme. And I try to, as I meditate on God's law, ask the Lord to show me, you know, what kind of health law are you trying to teach me from this first commandment? So some of them are easy, and some of them are a bit more difficult. Remember that we won't cover this one today, but remember what which commandment talks specifically about longevity, long life. The fifth one said, honor thy father and thy mother as thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God gives thee. So that's kind of an easy one, right? If you honor your parents, the Lord promises to give you a long life. So that's definitely a health law. And that's one reason why I think Okinawa is known for its longevity, right? It's a blue zone. Yeah. And a lot of the Asian communities have a tradition of honoring their fathers and their mothers. It seems like the Asian countries value their old people a little bit more than the Western society does. And so maybe that's one reason why many of the Asian countries live longer than the Western countries. And so the longest living country in all the world right now, do you know what country that is? Japan. Japan is the longest living country in all the world right now. Within Japan, it used to be that Okinawa is the longest province in all of Okinawa. and the Lord's hand. Open up the mouth with power in the Lord's hand. But guess, I think there are 47 provinces in Japan. Guess what Okinawa is now today? 20? Lower? Five? Number five? Five from the top? Five from the bottom. Actually, you're dead last. Dead last right now. Okinawa is the shortest living province in all of Japan right now. Okinawa used to be number one like 5-6 years ago. They were still doing pretty good. 1, 2, 3, somewhere around there. Right now, it's dead last. Why is that? It's just a few short years. What happened? That's one of the big reasons I'm here today. We started a series of health talks last year. Okinawa crisis. What happens? The longevity of Okinawa. We need to bring that back up. And that's kind of the theme of the health talks that we're giving in Okinawa. We'll be doing that again tomorrow at for public evangelism. But I believe there are specific reasons why Okinawa is so dramatically fallen on that longevity scale. But that's not our subject for today. So we also have no other God before me. And when you think about this first commandment, you immediately think about idols, right? These ancient people bowing down and worshiping other gods. And that's all well and good. There's a lot of spiritual lessons we need to learn from that, and not having anything more superior than God. God should be our most important thing in this life, right? So that's a very important lesson. There's an interesting text here in Philippians 3:19. Paul here is talking about people. He says, "For many walk of whom I have told you often and now tell you weeping, that they are the enemies of Christ." And after that, he says, "Whose end is destruction, whose God is their what? Whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind perfect things." We have a lot of people in the world today who worship their belly as their God. Unfortunately, there are many people who are making their appetites and their stomachs the number one God that they worship. If it tastes good, eat it. It's their model, right? Without giving any thought as to does it glorify God? Does it good for my body? If it tastes good, eat it. And Paul says, people who make their God their belly their God, are going to be destroyed in the end. And so that first commandment is a very important health teaching. Obesity, as a result of overeating, overindulgence, is killing many, many people worldwide. Of course, we've seen a lot of these statistics. 1 billion overweight adults worldwide, 300 million obese. In the US, one out of every three persons is actually obese, medically obese. And if you just if you take overweight people into account also, 2 out of 3 people, more than half the population in the US, has a problem with weight. And obesity really becoming an epidemic worldwide. A lot of people think that the Asians don't have such a problem. You don't see so many, hugely obese people in Japan. But guess what? The health researchers are finding something very interesting. You know the BMI charts that the doctors look at, whatever your height is, your weight should be around this much. Those BMI charts were done by taking mostly Caucasian people and measuring their height and weight and seeing if they were healthy or not, okay? The Asian community, the Hispanic community, and I think the Black community also, they said you might need to have a different BMI chart for each race. Because they're finding that, especially for the Asian people, that's what I was looking at. The Asian people, they do not handle body fat very well at all. I mean, you don't see very many fat people, but what they call the fat central obesity. the fact that tiles up around your internal organs, that's especially genetic. And for patients, you might not look obese. If you have a lot of internal fat near your internal organs, they handle that fat much more poorly than the Caucasians. So the Caucasians that have a lot of fat around you, the legs, the face, and everywhere. And they can handle it fairly well. So they can be obese. And but it is a health risk the heavier you are. But for the Asians, if they have a little bit of fat, if it's centered in their gut, it's a lot more deadly for the Asians. And so the medical authorities are saying we might have to revise our BMI tables so that even a little bit of fat for the Asian population, the Hispanic and the blacks, may not be good. All right. This is the last day this year. There's a restaurant in Las Vegas. It's called the Heart Attack Grill. And if you wait over, over 350 pounds, you need to eat the quadruple bypass burger. This is going to have the quadruple bypass burger. It's like 9,000 calories, I believe. Yeah, 9,000 calories. One burger. How much does a big muscular man need in one day? Calories.
2,000?
Yeah, 2,000. About 2,000, 2,500. If you're really active, sweating in the millions or something, maybe 3,000. This is a quadruple bypass burger, 9,000 calories. Can you believe that? I have these guys, flatliner burgers, fried in pure lard. when the Bible talks about the glory in their shame, this is it. They just glory in their shame. And for the reason we tell them about the man, they had a some story about what happened at the restaurant one night, a heart attack. Yeah, the guy actually had a heart attack in the restaurant. They thought he was just part of a media campaign, the coffee was filming a commercial or something, and he was laughing, but he was actually having a hard time right in the restaurant. As you walk into that restaurant, he said, caution, this establishment is bad for your health. They glory in their shame. I said, you come in here, this is going to be bad for your health. But it tastes good, so come in anyway. Right? People are glorying in their shame and their pain. Of course, that's just an extreme example of what man does. But McDonald's, all these drive-ins, all these fast food joints, pretty much the same thing. You're getting no nutritional value, hardly any nutritional value, and you're just there to satisfy your belly. The people's God is their belly. It tastes good. You've heard about that man, supersizing. What was his name again? The man who did that film, Supersize Me. Anyway, he wondered what would happen if I just ate at McDonald's for 30 days. One month. Just ate nothing else except what they sell at McDonald's. He almost killed himself, right? He had a doctor following him, and he was going to checkups every once in a while. He was perfectly healthy at the beginning of the project. Toward the end of the project, his doctor said, you gotta quit this, you're killing yourself. His triglycerides, his cholesterol levels, he's just going out of the back of his liver, he gets shot, and he said, you gotta quit this stuff, you're gonna kill yourself. Just 30 minutes of getting up with that. This is one of the big reasons why I believe Okinawa has had this dramatic drop in their longevity. KFC, McDonald's, AMW, all of these places, we have more fast food restaurants in Okinawa than any other province in Japan. So I think this is one of the big reasons why this huge drop. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. There's a flip side of what we've been talking about, making Baal your god. Have you heard this word before, orthorexia? Orthorexia. It's not an official medical term yet, but it comes from the Greek orthos. We get like orthodontics, orthopedics, to make right, to make straight. And then it has anorexia. That's from eating disorder. So anorexia, we know about, it's an eating disorder where you just stop eating. Orthorexia is a disorder where you're so concerned about eating right, eating the right foods, that you make yourself sick. You're so concerned about, being labeled, is there any GMO in here? Are there any pesticides in here? Is there any, I can't even have an iota of chocolate or, a bunch of sugar here, not for me. It becomes all obsessed with eating right, that you make yourself sick. And more people coming down with something like this, and it's not an official medical term yet, but in medical circles, they're starting to come down with this. And we're starting to use this more and more. Orthorexia involves extreme or excessive preoccupation with avoiding foods perceived to be unhealthy. And many times, these people have very good intentions, right? They want to live a good, healthy life, they want to live a clean lifestyle, they want to avoid all the junk foods, but they become so obsessed with eating pure food that they make themselves sick. Healthy eating can become a god. So that's kind of the flip side of what Paul was talking about, where he said, people make their god their belly, they overindulge. You can make your heart your belly by saying pure food, pure living, right living is so important to me that everything else doesn't matter. I must have my pure food. I'm so obsessed with it. And that's all you think about all day, all night. And that can become your God. And God says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Even eating right can become a god. I remember my undergraduate studies in college. I had some classes with a doctor. He was a public health doctor, but his wife was a very kind of health nut. She loved to run, a very fit person, and every morning she ran 5 miles. And is that a good thing to exercise?
Yes.
It's a very important health principle, right? 5 miles, that sounds a bit excessive, but it's a good thing to have exercise every day. So she had to have a 5 miles run, no matter what was happening outside, no matter what the weather was, no matter what was going on in her home. Everything else was secondary. She had to have a 5 mile run. And I don't know if that was the reason why he not went wrong with his professor. He was divorced. The family fell apart. Exercise is a great thing. Eating clean foods, the right foods, is a wonderful thing. But even good things, if taken to excess, can become detrimental to your health, to your spirituality. So remember, orthorexia. Even a good thing can become your God. It's a moderation in all things, thou shalt not have any other gods before me. There's an interesting verse in Ecclesiastes 7:16. It says, be not righteous overmuch, neither make thyself overwise. Why shouldst thou destroy thyself? I used to struggle with this text because how do you become too righteous? Jesus Christ was the righteousness that we look for. Is there such a thing as being too righteous? And it seems like King Solomon said, don't be over righteous. Don't be over wise. How can you have too much wisdom? I'm not sure. when they need even righteousness, even wisdom, taken to extremes, will destroy you. So even God within is taken to excess. It's another Bible biblical teaching. Moderation in all things, right? God, the glory of God should be your number one concern. And righteousness, too much righteousness, I believe, is when you're trying to work out your righteousness, working out your own righteousness to excess, thinking that righteousness depends upon you. Wisdom depends upon you. You need to be studying. You need to be working at righteousness to be able to be worthy of going into heaven. Being righteous over much, trying to become wise over much. Will that do anything for you? You're actually destroying yourself when you do that. And that's why we have this Sabbath day. God says, you need to rest. One day out of seven, rest. It's a rest from our works, from our righteousness. When we recognize that it's only the righteousness that Jesus Christ covers us with, that makes us worthy of any of God's blessings. We need to let go and let God work in our lives. Let go of trying to exercise your way to heaven, trying to eat your way to heaven, trying to memorize texts to get to heaven. All of that is wonderful. It's great. But it's not why Jesus is going to take you to heaven. The righteousness of Jesus Christ. We don't try to go above and beyond that. It's very simple. Keep it simple. Here's another very interesting next quotation from Ellen White. She said, if you are in constant fear that your food will hurt you, it most assuredly will. Have you found that to be true? If you think your food is going to hurt you, it will hurt you. Exactly what these orthodoxic people, that's what they're, what's going on. Your mental attitude is it's very important. I remember my mother used to take care of Alzheimer's patients in their homes when I was growing up. I remember some of these Alzheimer's patients, if you leave some food in the garbage, they'll go in there and start eating. If it looks good, let's start eating from the garbage bag. Mm-hmm. And they hardly ever get sick. The person who was still in their right mind did that, speaking about it, would probably make them sick, right? But Alzheimer's, you know, they not in your right mind, they start eating the garbage, and they just make them sick. Your mind has a powerful effect on your body. If you think it's going to make you sick, then the wife says, it most sure will. Of course, there are people, whenever I give this talk, there are many people who say, yeah, so I can just eat whatever I want and ask God to bless it, and if I think it will make me healthy, it will make me healthy. Is that what I'm saying? Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying what you eat doesn't make any difference in your health. It does. It surely does. What you eat is important to your health. So don't obsess about it. We have to choose. We have to learn how to cook healthy. We have to learn how to be able to choose the right foods that are best for our bodies. You do the best that you can, whatever situation you're in. If you're in Okinawa, you might be able to get some foods that you can't get in the States. If you were living in Antarctica, boy, your food choices are going to be very limited, right? You might not even be able to be a vegan in Antarctica. But if God calls you there, if you're there doing the Lord's work, you do the best that you can, and the Lord's going to bless you. Even if you do have to eat meat, it's not going to kill you. If you think it's going to hurt you, it most assuredly will. So don't go overboard, right? So GMO, pesticides, yes, those are not the best for our bodies. And we should do our best to avoid those things. Well, if you can't find those things, if it's hard to recognize those things, government won't label it for you. And then every once in a while, you get a little bit of GMO corn or a little bit of pesticide in your piece that you're eating. Is it going to kill you? No, it's not. It's not. And I have people coming to my clinic all the time who are so obsessed about acid and alkaline foods. Oh, can I mix this with that food? It's going to make my blood acid. And I'm going to die from cancer. It is true. Acid-based balance in your body is very important. The Lord has given our bodies such wonderful abilities that a lot of people can put a lot of abuse in their bodies and will not repent. Okay? The longest living person in the world today, I believe she's still alive, she might just be passed away after that. But the longest living person in the world, I believe she was like 117 years old. You know what her diet was? In the age of when she was like a young lady, she ate like three eggs a day. She loves raw meat and very little vegetables. And she loves eggs and meat. That's pretty much what she ate since about, I can't forget the details, but during the latter years of her life, that's all she was eating, eggs and then meat, a lot of it raw. And she still lived to be 117 years old. And fairly healthy, too. Okay, so I'm not saying, don't get me wrong. Whatever you eat is okay. I'm not saying that. Don't obsess about what you eat, what you mean. God will bless you. Do the best that you can. And then the rest, be with the Lord. Your mind has much more of a powerful effect on your body than most of us here. Health reformers, above all others, should be careful to avoid extremes. You have to avoid extremes. So this is the bottom line. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, you all to the glory of God. And eating and drinking healthily, it's not just so that you can live long. It's so that you can preserve your mind as clear as possible, so that the Holy Spirit can talk to you, so that God can be glorified through you. That's the main purpose of why we're doing this. It's not so that I can live 3 or 4 years longer than my neighbor down the road. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Make God your first priority in all that you do. Make Him the best. Give Him the best of your time and your talents and your resources, and not just the leftovers. Right? Make Him the most important thing in your life. There's another aspect, one last aspect of this first commandment. Another might say, "Round of blessings," page 100. When we take into our hands the management of things with which we have to do and depend upon our own wisdom for success, we are taking a burden which God has not given us and are trying to bear it without His aid. When God promises us, trust in me. Cast all your burdens upon the Lord, right? God is inviting us to do that. And when we think that, we have to work hard, we have to bear these burdens so that we can make this work and engage in the success. God says, you're taking a burden that belongs to me. He says, we are taking upon ourselves the responsibility that belongs to God, and thus are really putting ourselves in His place. We're making ourselves our own gods when we think we have to do everything to make our lives a success. Because God says, you just follow my commandments, you follow my statutes, and I'll be responsible for your health, for your salvation, for your success. When we worry and when we stress about making our lives a success, and God said, you're putting yourself where I should be. And that's idolatry. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. heart disease and anxiety. You know, of course, we know that smoking tobacco is very bad for your heart, increases your risk of dying from a heart attack, but anxiety, worrying about things, increases your risk of sudden cardiac death by 4.5 times. Smoking increases your risk by only 2 times. So, being a very anxious person, worrying about everything, you're more at risk of dying from a heart attack than a person who is smoking a couple times a day. The way you carry your heart and your mind may be even more important than health, individual health practices. Luke 21:36. Men's hearts are failing them with fear, and they're looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. You know, heart disease, heart attacks are the number one killer in the world right now, right? The number one cause of death in the world. Men's hearts will be failing them from fear. This is a heart attack. People's hearts are failing because of fear. And it's pretty common for people to be fearful in our world today. We'll talk a little bit about this morning. But when we look at what's happening in the world today, many people's hearts are filled with fear. And because of this fear, this anxiety, they're coming down with heart attacks and they're dying. Because of this fear, this anxiety in their hearts. And so, yes, exercise is important for minimizing the risk of heart failure. Eating the right foods is very important. Drinking enough water, getting sunshine, getting rest. It's all very important for minimizing your risk for heart attack, heart disease. May be even more important than that. Are you resting in the Lord Jesus Christ? Have you given your life completely over to the Lord Jesus Christ? That may be even more important than your physical health habits, for minimizing your risk or even heart disease. Right? Here's the ultimate answer. Matthew 11:28 says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and a heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The rest that Jesus gives is mental rest, spiritual rest, physical rest. That's the rest, the assurance that we need in this spiritual world that we live in. That's the only true rest that any one of us can have. We rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, "I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have put upon these Egyptians." This is my last slide here. This is a wonderful occasion for ministry, page 71. It says, "He is watching over you, trembling child of God. Are you tempted? He will deliver. Are you weak? He will strengthen you. Are you ignorant? He will enlighten. Are you wounded? He will heal." Whatever the struggle that you may be going through, whether it be sin, temptation, whether it be physical weakness, you need strength. Are you ignorant and mentally challenged? Whatever are you wounded? You have that disease that you're fighting. Whatever your need may be right now, God says, "I will fill that need in your life." When I do my audition work overseas, I always take this as my last slide. And my wife is a musician, and she composes music, and she likes to do scripture songs. And she put some music into this quotation here. And when I went to Papua New Guinea, every meeting that I did, I ended with this, and I sang them this song. And I was there for about 3 weeks. And at the end of 3 weeks, when we were all getting ready to go back, the natives there who we did that we were ministering to, they sang this song back to me in our last meeting in like, it sounded like more than 4 parts. They harmonized the whole thing. I was just singing to them melody. They sang it back to me in like 4 or 8 part harmony. Just beautiful. And anyway, I'd like to sing this song to you once, and hope you can learn a little bit of it anyway. So build something like this. Which is, I have my family here sitting along with me, sitting 4 or 5 minutes.
He is watching over you, trembling child of God. Are you tempted? He will deliver. Are you weak? He will strengthen. Are you ignorant? He will enlighten. Are you wounded? He will heal. Ministry of Healing 71.
Try singing that with me. Try singing that together. You can follow
along. He is watching over you, trembling child of God. Are you tempted? He will deliver. Are you weak? He will strengthen. Are you ignorant? He will enlighten. Are you wounded? He will heal. Ministry of healing 71.
All right, this is how I have the word of prayer, and right after this prayer we'll have a little time where we can make questions and answers. Until I have the word of prayer. Father in heaven, we are so thankful for your law. David said, it is my meditation all the day, how I love your law. Lord, we have seen just a little glimpse of the wonders that we have put into these 10 short commandments. Lord, we pray that, like King David, we will take the time to meditate, to dig deep into your word, so that you can teach us more and more wonderful things out of your heart. We thank you for this time we have had together, and I pray that you will be with each of my brothers and sisters here in Okinawa, and that you will bless their efforts to reach the world, the corner of the world that you have given them here in Okinawa. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. That was the commandment number one. And I usually go through, I got through at our church, doing all 10 at our church. It takes like 1 hour for each commandment. But every time I did it, I learned something new. So we don't have time to cover it anymore. But if you have any questions about this one or any other health related, spiritual question related thing, I'd be happy to share with you what the Lord has taught me. But I think the person that's going to get me to my next place, we've done about 4 o'clock, so we have about 5-10 minutes here. Anyone have a question, a comment?
Yes, Dr. Kenyo. What's your thoughts or assessment on how we as a church are doing in using the right arm, the right hand of health to reach the different communities that we're planning in? How do you think we're doing considering we have the health message?
Yeah, okay. Very good question. Kind of a controversial question. So, but, I'll address it as best I can. The Lord has given great light, great talent to our church. And definitely we have made great strides within the medical community, right? We are known as a denomination that has medical facilities all over the world. And praise God for that. Our hospitals are doing a wonderful work in I believe they are doing a wonderful work in reaching the community. However, here's the but. However, by and large, we are competing with the world using worldly methods, right? The hospitals that we run are pretty much the same as the hospitals that the world runs. I mean, we have the same model of care that they use. Maybe a little bit different in that, you know, we can have many godly physicians, godly staff who will, I believe we can still pray for many of the patients that come in. I've heard that some hospitals don't even allow that anymore, but I believe most of our Adventist hospitals do have, you know, we encourage staff to pray with the patients. So a lot of wonderful spiritual aspects added to patient care, and that is a wonderful thing. But like I read in one of our quotations this afternoon, Ellen White said, we have trained bedside nurses. And she was referring to, you know, we trained nurses to be hospital nurses, where God's plan was that we go out into the community, knocking on doors, and these health workers, medical missionaries, going door to door and saying, you know, I read about one account where back in the day, the conference actually supported medical doctors. They paid them a salary, not a big salary, not as much as a minister. And these doctors would go around the communities, knocking on the neglected population of the city. They would knock on and say, you know, is there anyone sick here? And they would say, you know, oh yeah, we have some sick people, but I can't afford to go to the doctor, go to the hospital. And they would say, that's no problem. I can come and, you know, treat you. I can do some simple treatments here. And the medical doctor, they actually go door to door, going into people's homes and offering to, you know, help wherever they could. That was the kind of, the medical missionary that actually opened the door. You know, I remember my dad telling me about Adventist Medical Center here in Okinawa. They used to do a lot of medical procedures. They had teams that would go out to far islands and do medical clinics and do evangelism and different outreach programs. And sure, they, you know, the medical center now still carries on some kind of an outreach program. But we're doing, let's say this. The Lord's plan was kind of different from what we're trying to do right now. We weren't supposed to be competing with the world in giving hospital care. We were to have a unique program on sanitariums, healthcare facilities out in the country, where people could be taught about the 8 natural doctors that our brother Lisa was talking about. Praise the Lord, we do need hospitals. We do need emergency care facilities. Every lecture that I give, I tell them, you know, if I'm in an accident and I'm bleeding out, my arm is just hanging by a thread, don't take me to a naturopathic clinic where they'll give me some poultices and herbs and hydrotherapy. Take me to the emergency room, right? Where I can get sewn up and they can do wonderful work in trauma cases and sew my arm back on and save my life. Praise the Lord for emergency medicine. Praise the Lord for our hospitals. But the world is doing a wonderful job with that kind of hospital work also. Adventists had a unique health message to give to the world. Using drugs less and less, and educating the people along that lifestyle principles so that you don't get sick. And I think that's where we've come far short of what God wants us to do. So, you know, praise God for how He has blessed us. We should be doing much more. And that's one reason why I think why Jesus has been able to come back here. With the right hand, and that needs to open people's hearts, the doors. It's kind of like a withered right hand. It's doing a good work. But we could be doing so much more. You know, the sad thing is, like as far as the natural remedies go, the world is catching up. In many respects, the world has passed us up. Is this being recorded?
Yeah.
Take it.
That's not all right. It's interesting when I was at Memorial University, there was a pharmacology course. We had one course on herbs. It was It was an optional course. It wasn't going to be on the test. It wasn't going to be on the medical exam, so you didn't have to come if you didn't want to. So as medical students, you know, we're all swamped for time. Hardly anyone shows up, right? One course on nerves, and it was taught. I'm pretty sure it was taught by a non athlete. Nutrition. Nutrition is a huge, very, very important part of health principles. But the typical medical curriculum, you get a little bit of it in your biochemistry curriculum. Not too much on holistic nutrition education. When I switched over to naturopathic medicine, one of the first classes I had to take in the last year of university was a cooking class for all the naturopathic physicians. They said, if you're going to teach your patients that they need to eat healthy, you, the doctor, you need to be able to cook healthy. And so a cooking class was one of the first classes I had to take at the naturopathic medical school. And you know, we come up with recipes for, you know, if you have diabetes, what kind of recipe would you come up with? If you have heart disease, what kind of menu would you come up with? So we cook those things ourselves. They had an organic garden right inside the school, an herb garden right inside the school, and we could go out and pick whatever we needed, and we cook it ourselves, and we serve it to one another, and we critique each other on the menu and things like that. And then we, even though in the university, we fall far short of what we could have been doing. And I think the rocks are crying out now because we have dropped the ball on this. And the world is catching up and surpassing us now along natural medicine. You know, but we're prisoners of hope. We have a unique vision of what the health world could do. And God is not limited in what he can do, and if we have people who will devote themselves completely to the Lord, forgetting what the world might think, forgetting about, you know, am I going to be able to sustain my life, you know, as far as finances, God will take care of those things if we devote ourselves to his work. We're doing a good work. I don't want to minimize that. All of our doctors and surgeons out there, our nurses, our hospitals, they're doing a wonderful work. So we could be doing so much more.
Amen. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else a comment or question?
Hi, Dr. According to your message, Of course, overeating would be bad for your health. And as well as, like, if you are overthinking that this food is bad for your health, it will also be bad for your health, right? But what can you say about the people who age well, like 100 years old people, but their diet was, I saw this lady who was smoking all his life, and then there's another person who drink alcohol all his life.
Yeah.
So is there any explanation?
Okay. Yeah, we can talk about that a little bit, you know, that the world's oldest person, 170 years old, and, you know, it's true. There are people who say, I never drink anything except alcohol and whiskey. That's all I drink. I don't drink water. And they live to be like, you know, 100 years old and in very good health. My question would be, can we all do that? And live to be 100 years old? Definitely not. There are individual characteristics of our health. When we start in our health, it's very different. Some people can handle alcohol very efficiently. The first cup of alcohol is poison to our bodies. You start losing brain cells with the first drink that you take. So it is a poison in our bodies. But some people have very efficient enzyme system where they can break down that alcohol very well, and it doesn't affect them as much. So, yeah, there may be some people who live to be healthy 100 years old, drinking whiskey every day of their lives, but that does not mean that you can do that. That person, if he had kept the health principles, how much more happier would he have been? How much more healthy would he have been? We don't know. But yes, so for individuals here and there, you know, all of our bodies, we're all built in different ways. And so we always need to take that into consideration. Even Ellen White, she said that beans were death to her. I don't know what she meant. She didn't elaborate, but she said beans were death to her. That's a nutritious food. It's a wonderful food for most people, but for her, she's not hungry. And so what's good for me may not be the best for you. And so we can't judge one another, especially with our health habits, you know. There are a lot of principles, but how you apply those principles is you need to have wisdom from God to apply individual details of these principles to our lives. So each of those people who think, you know, how can they live so long and healthy? By breaking all of these health laws, I was thinking, how much more happy, how much more fulfilling life if they have led, if they hadn't known about these health laws and hadn't kept those things. But and it does not give anyone license to do what they were doing. Okay, very good. One moment.
So I regarded the translation. When I watched your DVD before, I think I remember you said that berries are good for our health. And so when we drink raspberry, is that healthy?
That specifically kill germs.
Oh, okay. So that's the question.
So our raspberries, all kinds of these fruits, especially berries, are a wonderful superfood, right? They contain all kinds of antioxidants and other phytochemicals that really do improve our health. Now, these raspberries have a special germ-killing power to kill germs. I'm not sure about that, but it is a very good source for antioxidants, vitamins, minerals, but as far as killing germs, I'm not too sure about that. It will definitely help to strengthen the immune system, but as far as killing germs, I'm not sure. But antioxidants. What kind of antioxidants? I'm not sure. Yeah. But there are plants, there are other plants that definitely do kill germs. So like garlic is one of our best natural antibiotics. It's a broad spectrum antibiotic. And so that's one of the first things that we can use. There's another herb, maybe some of you have heard about golden seal. Golden seal is a very bright yellow root that we use. And that's a powerful, powerful antibiotic. And in natural medicine, we use that as our first antibiotic when people are fighting with infections and things like that. And there are other plants that will help with viruses. Garlic, of course, is a good one, but if you're fighting a viral illness, there's another berry. Just slipped my mind. What's that? No. It's a dark blue, small blue berry. We have to move the rest quite a bit. Blueberries are great, but there's another
mulberries.
Mulberries?
Blackberries.
Blackberries are great. Elderberry. Elderberry. That's specific for viral illness. It's really good at killing viruses and so on. So there are specific berries that will be effective for different things. So, you know, you have to study a little bit. But God is placed in nature. Many of the things that we need, so that we don't have to run down to the office every time we get sick. A lot of you can study about herbs and things like that. I'll tell you this one. There's one plant that grows just about anywhere man has been. We think of it as a pest, and in America we spend millions and millions of dollars every year trying to get rid of this from our lawns. What do you think it is? Dandelions. Dandelions. It's a wonderful healing herb. Dandelions, the aerial part, the part that grows above ground, dandelions, they're great for your kidneys. They help you with urination, detoxing your blood, great for the kidneys. And then the bottom part, the roots, they're great for your liver. It detoxifies the kitchen, strengthens and helps the liver. And back in the World War II, when the coffee was being rationed and people didn't have coffee, they actually had dandelion coffee. They dried the dandelion roots and ground it up, roasted it. It tastes pretty good. And it's actually good for the liver, helping support the liver. So, I think God knew that man would be very toxic in the end. And so, he has this dandelion follow us wherever man goes. It grows in confusion wherever man has dug into the earth. And it's actually not a weed, but it's a healing herb. A lot of the herbs that we try so hard to get rid of have wonderful healing qualities.
Yeah.
So like the root, you can dry it and use it like a tea, boil it. The leaf, you can definitely dry it out and use it as a tea also. And that kind of leaf, if you can get a good clean source, you can eat it as a vegetable. It's very good. It's slightly like bitter taste, but it tastes really good.
And if it's multiple use for that, another solution is rubber?
Rubber, that's right.
What we are releasing them is the quality of the lion.
Yeah, the dandelion milk, the white milky substance that comes out, and then to snap that out into some white, that's latex. And people are thinking of using that as a source of latex, for rubber. But you can use that, as a remedy for warts. If it's a minor small wart, you get that latex from the dandelion, and you apply that to that wart. Just do that faithfully, and in a few weeks, that wart just kind of disappears. I tried that myself. All right, I think that's about all the time that we have. Thank you so much for listening. And I did this series on the internet, at a church, and we put it on the internet. So if you want to learn more about the Ten Commandments of Health, all 10 series. You can go to YouTube and type in it's Linwood Adventist Church. Linwood. Linwood Adventist Church. And hopefully those videos will come online. And so I think the ones that I've given our church, they should be online on YouTube. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Dr. Kinzer, before you go, one last request, we'll let you go.
Okay.
I'm going to ask if you would be gracious in that.